Hi, I'm Michael Yardney, and there have been some mighty big changes going on in the world of property finance over the last month or so. In fact, some of the most significant and fastest occurring changes I've come across, and they're going to affect property investors, all property investors to some degree. So to help you understand what they may mean to you as a property investor, let's just do a quick question and answer. First of all, what happened? Well, in short, the Australian Prudential Regulation Authority, usually called APRA, has introduced directives aimed at curbing investor borrowing. The reason behind APRA's involvement is the significant growth of lending to property investors, particularly in Australia's two largest capital city property markets, in the Melbourne and the Sydney property markets. Now, just to make things clear, APRA weren't really that concerned about property prices. They were a little bit, but they really wanted to ensure the stability of our banking sector. After all, that's their job. So back in December 2014, APRA recommended the banks restrict the annual growth in their residential property investment loans to 10% or less year on year. But it appeared to have little effect on investor home loan approvals, with investor loans creeping up to over 50% of all lending. So in May this year, APRA tightened the screws, causing several major banks to significantly change their lending policy to property investors. Then at the end of June, APRA released a temporary directive to five of the big banks requiring them to increase the amount of capital they hold against their residential mortgage exposure. What this means is that the ANZ, Commonwealth Bank, National Australia Bank, Westpac and Macquarie Bank are going to have to retain billions of dollars that otherwise would have gone out in home loans. The result is likely to be more expensive mortgages and reduced mortgage volume. So how have the banks responded? Well, put simply, they've made money harder to get and more expensive for property investors. Changes introduced by some of the banks include amended loan serviceability calculations, including their stress testing them. Well, in other words, what they're wanting to do is understand, can you afford loan repayments if interest rates rose to 7.5% or more? And also if you could afford to pay principal interest payments. Clearly, this would knock out some marginal investors if you worked out their serviceability at these higher rates. The second thing they did was remove negative gearing concessions from some of their calculations. They also restricted maximum loan-to-value ratios to about 80% for investors and 70% for self-managed super funds. And they reduced discretionary pricing on investor loans. In other words, they raised the price of loans for property investors. For investors, this essentially means the need for a bigger deposit and an increased onus on proving your ability to service the loans throughout the term. So how is this going to affect our property markets? Last week I wrote about the changes that I saw as a ticking time bomb for those who bought properties off the plan. To my mind, thousands of investors face financial ruin because many of those who bought off the plan, they're just not going to be able to complete their finance for their purchases. I also think the new house and land market would be affected, but the existing housing market in established suburbs and our big capital cities are unlikely to be significantly affected. It's likely some of the heat's going to come out of the capital city in a suburban established apartment markets, because if you think about it, that's where there's been a lot of competition from investors over the last couple of years. The upside of this, of course, is going to be there's going to be more stock to choose from and less competition. While prices in this market are unlikely to fall, I think capital growth is going to be a little bit lower over the next couple of years. Now, this is a good thing. The rate of property price growth, over the last few years, especially in the Melbourne and Sydney markets, was unsustainable. So slower growth means an increased likelihood of a gentle landing when the market slows down. So we're going to get a gentler landing rather than the crash. The changes are likely to have a smaller impact on apartment prices in Brisbane and Perth, where currently the number of investors in those markets is much less. So how will this affect beginning investors? Well, in my mind, first-time investors usually get into the market with highish loan-to-value ratios, and very often they use lenders' mortgage insurance, and they're the ones that are going to be hit the hardest. Many are going to have difficulty scraping the 20% deposit required or proving their ability to service loans. Those who in the past would have bought at the lower price points, they're going to struggle to afford what I call investment-grade properties, properties in good locations and the right sort of property. In my opinion, these investors should be patient and avoid the temptation to get in the market at any cost, because otherwise they're going to end up buying secondary properties. How will this affect existing investors? Well, existing investors will be hit with a slightly increased interest rate unless you've got fixed rate loans. However, investors with strong incomes and good equity, they're still going to be able to obtain loans. They're going to be in a great position to add to their property portfolio. After all, the banks are really just money shops. They need to lend money to make a profit. But some existing investors with large portfolios, with multi-property portfolios, who plan to release equity to purchase another property, they could be hit hard by the new serviceability requirements. You see, even though prevailing interest rates generally are around 4.5%, maybe 5% interest only, the banks are likely to assess these investors, particularly their ability to service loans on their entire portfolio, with an interest rate in the order of 7.5%, and if they could pay principal and interest. Now that's vastly different, and it'll make it a lot harder for some existing investors to refinance and in the short term to grow their portfolio. So the bottom line is that APRA is going to get what it wanted. It's going to cool down the investor property market. Clearly we're going to be in for some interesting times as these changes work their way through the system. The upside is that anything that prevents our property markets from a solid downturn, that's really a good thing. And there's no sugarcoating it. If the Sydney and Melbourne property markets kept steaming along as they had over the last few years, we were setting ourselves up for a significant slump. Not a crash, but a significant slump. So if you're looking to buy a new home, there's probably never been a better time. And if you're a long-term property investor, there'll be some great opportunities in the current markets. But as always, even more so than always, careful property selection will be critical. If you want to get some assistance to understand what your finance capacity is, and even more importantly, to see what's going to be a good property to add to your portfolio, or if you're a beginner wanting to get in the market, why not have a chat with the team at Metropole? We have no properties for sale, but we've got access to every property on the market, which makes our advice independent and unbiased. Just give the team at Metropole a call, and we look forward to being part of your wealth creation team.